Bueno, vamos a ir empezando. I think we're going to mix English and Spanish. Sorry for that. But I guess most of you understand both. Otherwise, you have this translation kit to, to hear the rest.
It's fine.
Ya hemos visto que nos enfrentamos a una cuarta revolución industrial, algo que hacemos encantadas, porque al final la vida va de esto. Tenemos una cuarta revolución industrial porque tuvimos una primera, una segunda y una tercera. Y aquí buscaremos vías para entender cómo tendremos que afrontarla. So, facing this fourth industrial revolution, we are first welcoming today Katharina Schüller. I'm going to make very short presentations because we are short of time and lots of things have to be said here. Katharina is a mother of four. She's a role model for women and as a consultant through StatUp, she's helping companies develop data strategies and to create value. And she's going to explain us, I guess, how to tackle data and get the most of it under an ethical perspective.
Yes, thank you very much for this introduction. We often say that data are the oil of the 21st century, but why is it so? There are several things in that they have in common. First, data spring like oil. Second, we find more and more new applications, both for oil and for data. And third, we are not really interested in oil. We are interested in the value that is created from oil. And I do not mean fuel or plastic packaging. I'm talking about mobility and freshness. And as well, we are also not interested in data products like statistics or analytics. But we are interested in the value that we can create from data, and I mean that is better decisions. But how do we get to data-driven decisions? And this is a very simplified model of how we can do so. First, we start with removing context in order to get to the core of information. We measure the real world and then we get data. If we clean the data, we will get information. And then we will again add context to make a meaning of that information. We connect the new information with information we already know, get to new knowledge. And if we interpret and apply that knowledge, we will get to decisions or to the power to act. So we give the data meaning, but the meaning is not part of the data. And this is very important. We need to distinguish between data and the meaning of data. And there's an example. Oh, sorry. There is an example that I would like to talk about. It was a study that was cited quite a lot in the German media about women on the DAX 30 boards. I'm talking about executive boards. And this was during 2014, we had this huge discussion about the women's quota in Germany. And the study from Simon Kucher and partners said that females who had resigned from those DAX 30 boards had been there on average for 3 years, but men who had resigned had there been for 8 years. And their interpretation was, obviously, gender was sometimes more important than the best professional capability. But this is the information that we add, and that could be our expert knowledge, it could be our gut feeling, or simply our prejudices. So the interpretation was those token women, they are token women, and they are less capable. But is this really what the data tells us, or is it just what some people want to hear from the data? So let's start with the data and see what the results are. This sample shows the fraction of women on the boards of the DAX 30 companies, executive boards, for the last per year, and it starts in 2000, goes to 2014. What we can see is that before 2007, there was no woman on board, not one single woman, So by 2014, there was no chance that a woman could have been there for 8 years, even not for 7 years. So it makes no sense to compare that fraction for women and men, or to compare that average retention time. So it's simple calculus. So, and also, why do we ignore those women who are still on the boards? And are there other factors that we must take into account to explain the difference in retention times? That's what we did in our analysis. We only compared board members that started in 2007 or later, and we looked at other potentially explaining factors. One factor was the company experience, and we found that there was a large correlation between company experience and the retention time, saying that those who came from outside, they leave earlier. This is something you can see. You cannot see it. It's on the left side, upper left side. Less left active means they're still on board, and ausgeschieden, the German word is for they have resigned. You see exactly the same pattern when you look at males and females. And then we also looked at the board section and found that it's crucial for HR to know the company from inside and to have a strong external network in the company. So we found that those who came from outside had a very hard time to survive in HR. So age and education showed no correlation to the retention time, and we see that it's typically female to come from the outside and to join as an HR director. So females have a systematically disadvantage. Then we used those factors in an appropriate statistical model, which is called a survival analysis. And it does nothing else than showing what would happen if men and women had exactly the same characteristics. So we adjusted for those factors like HR section and coming from outside or inside. Result is the combination of both factors is lethal, both for men and women. And the remaining difference of the retention times, it is not statistically significant. That means it's purely random. So women are not less capable than men to do a director's job. So ethical literacy is crucial because we want to take better decisions with the help of data. So we need to understand the risk of negative outcomes if we deal with data uncritically and do not distinguish between data and the meaning of data. And this is the fourth parallel between oil and data. If we deal with oil uncritically, then we have negative outcomes like traffic jams, like fine dust and plastic waste in the oceans. If we deal with data uncritically, then we have negative outcomes like discrimination of job candidates, violation of intimacy, manipulation of elections like we have in Bolivia right now, or simply bad legislation. And I will show you a few examples of what can happen if we deal with data and algorithms uncritically. First one is the project of gender shades. It shows how algorithms for image recognition are significantly worse in classifying women of color than in classifying white men. And there was also the case of Amazon. They tried to improve their application process with an algorithm, and the result was that almost only white men were invited for interviews because the training data showed that they had a significantly higher chance of getting a job offer. So the bias was programmed into the algorithm. Another recent example is a tweet that I found on Twitter from a digital expert who's also a best-selling author, and he wrote, "The Apple Card is such a fucking sexist program. My wife and I filed joint tax returns, live in a community property state, and have been married for a long time, yet Apple's black box algorithm thinks I deserve 20 times the credit limit. She does no appeals work." So it shows that if you put garbage data in, you will get garbage out. Data are not neutral, and algorithms can be wrong. They can be very wrong. But are algorithms ethical just because they do not make mistakes? No, not if we also take into account analytical fairness. There was a case where a journalist, an US journalist, had a miscarriage, and she complained that she still got advertisements for pregnant women and for mothers. But what else would we expect? Would it be better if we had an algorithm that makes less mistakes and that would maybe condole after a miscarriage? Is that what we want? Or if an algorithm shows a correct result, which we have on the right side, is that something that we would want? It shows that after a contact request, the LinkedIn algorithm shows which other users the requesting user had looked at. And you can see here there is Tatjana, Prinzessin von Bayern, but also Vivian Schmidt, who is a porno star. So would we want to know that, or would we want to appear in such a list? So I think these are the questions we need to discuss. And if you want to read more, we have conducted a study. It's called Future Skills, a Framework for Data Literacy, which deals a lot with ethics, value, and attitude in the context of data literacy. And it's, you can download it for free. It's in German, unfortunately. but maybe you can still understand. Thank you.
Thank you, Katharina. Our next speaker is Che Miller-Van Dijk. She's an award-winning D&I thought leader, founder, engagement expert, and recognized digital transformation pioneer, a social entrepreneur with long experience, a leading geographically far-flung and multidisciplinary and multicultural teams. And she speaks six languages, including Japanese and Russian, but no Spanish. She's going to speak in English today.
I'm very sorry, actually, that I don't speak Spanish. Yes, it's on my list.
It's on your list.
I just wanted to take my 10 minutes to share a bit of what exactly this digital disruption is that we're talking about and bring it down to a personal level and reinforce this the problem with the gender bias in tech, which I think also manifests itself in very strange things like these horrible headsets that don't fit women and are not made for wearing dresses. Am I right? I also had the opportunity to speak with the people who developed Alexa, and I said, you know, you were so close to making that gender neutral. It could have just been Alex. And the response was surprise that I was raising it as an issue and anger, like, how dare you insinuate that we might be sexist. And I think this is the environment that we're talking about. I call the internet like a locker room, a men's locker room, basically. And it makes me upset and afraid that the response that women have to this and that girls have to this that's consistent with what Dr. Rippon was sharing with us is that we close the laptop and walk away. And this is the absolute worst thing that we could do. But first, I want to quickly give some background on when we talk about, I mean, just to give you the urgency of the problem. We look at technology, that's been a common theme today, as a positive and as a negative. A lot of people say that technology is the answer, right? That it will equalize the lower half and the upper half. And I just like to put perspective on the question and say, you know, there's 7.3 billion people in the world, and this room, this country, this continent does not reflect reality, okay? Especially as Europeans, we are extremely spoiled in terms of the amount of technology that we have at our fingertips, even as women in Europe. However, the reality is that only one-third of the world has access to the internet. And among that one-third, less women than men, which is not necessarily the problem, except that the rate at which women are coming online is slower. So we're talking about a digital gender divide that is at risk of only increasing over time. This is why the situation is urgent. This is the first reason why the situation is urgent. Women don't have access to the internet around the world. And you think that in Europe we enjoy a privileged situation, and we do, but the same exact patterns exist. So I want you to ask yourselves, if these patterns exist here, what do they look like in Africa? What do they look like in Asia? And we have a lot of people in the audience who will be speaking over the coming days who can also tell you what the situation is in their parts of the world. But in Europe, do you know, half of the European population is digitally unskilled, zero digital skills, or low digital skills. Half of the European population. But that number is larger among women. That represents a 12 million person gap. So 12 million more women who have no or few digital skills in Europe compared to men. So lower access, less digital skills. And when the European Commission used to capture and share gendered data, I can tell you they don't do it anymore, or it's very, you have to scrape through it to find the trends. Even when we see fluctuations in skills levels, there's always a lag of about 10% between men and women. These are the statistics that I'm looking at. And especially, oh geez, this is the wrong presentation. Oh no, okay. I'm gonna try to distill it for you. Basically, I've had to crunch the data myself. So if you go to Eurostat and you try to see what has the trend been in terms of the third thing that I'm looking at, participation of women as IT experts in the workforce. So just do a thought exercise with me. These graphs are showing the same thing, but it's very complex. In a market where IT skills are very much in demand, which we understand, and the number of jobs in tech that are being filled are growing at a rate that is 12 times more the rest of the workforce, now representing a total of about 9 million tech specialists in Europe. Even though this number is growing exponentially, the participation of women has flatlined since 2005. So since 2005, in 15 years of the digital disruption, participation of women as experts in tech has not changed, even though the participation of men has grown at a rate that is exponential. So what we have as a problem is that women are not building and designing and leading in the digital society. And then when we talk about disruption, I want to bring this question, like I said, home to you a little more personally. How many of you actually use Uber? Or, keep your hands up, Airbnb, Netflix? So how many of your children have online classroom platforms like Google? So these are all what the disruption has done to our lives, right? There's not a moment in the day that we are not on our phones, that we are not accessing massive data in the cloud, and it is governing the way that we work. There are statistics that in Europe, for example, there will be, despite all of those challenges I said, without women being skilled or being employed in the sector, there is a demand for these skills in the workforce that in Europe will reach 1 million jobs unfilled next year in the tech sector. If you add in the airline industry and the entertainment industry and even education technology, that number is closer to 1.5 million. So every segment of our lives is impacted by digitization, and women are nowhere. These graphics also reflect the same thing, so I don't want to drill down into it too deeply. The only other thing, the only other statistic that I want to share with you is, besides the lack of girls and women who are skilled in digital, the lack of access to the technology, the lack of women experts in these areas, the other thing that I watch very carefully is the number of women entrepreneurs. How many of you are considering starting a new business, maybe on your own, venturing out as an entrepreneur? Maybe you are in business for yourself. How many of you consider that technology is an obstacle for you going out on your own? No? No, I can't start a website. I can't make an app. In my work with the Digital Leadership Institute, we have looked at this as a barrier to entry for young and mature women to becoming starters, and have made a distinction between what we call digitally enabled startup and digitally driven startup. And a lot of women, though we don't have research because you measure what you treasure, no one in Europe is measuring these numbers, women are not getting into their starting their own enterprises because they feel that a lack of digital skills is a barrier to entry. In the second case, in terms of actual tech-driven startup, this is where women are actually starting companies in data science or in artificial intelligence, Internet of Things. Again, there isn't research on it, but the unofficial number in Europe is that 10% of all tech founders are female. So, if you think in terms of what this means for the future of the European economy, for the future of women leading in the digital society, the picture is pretty grim. What do we do? Well, our organization is leading a lot of initiatives that are focusing on digital skills and entrepreneurship for girls, for teen and adult women. We also have a program that is actually an apprenticeship program to create women tech experts from scratch, focusing on mature women who are the ones who are hitting the glass ceiling and falling out of the system. And we also happen to run the European ADA Awards that are recognizing the top girls and women in the tech sector in Europe. And I can tell you our winner from 2 years ago was a Spanish data scientist named Nuria Oliver. I don't know if you know her. But so there are a lot of initiatives on the ground to address this lack of participation of girls and women. But I do think, I mean, I have a couple of key recommendations. One is stop victim blaming. So I really, again, appreciate what Dr. Rippon was saying about this male locker room culture that says women are not good at tech. We ourselves feel we are not good at tech. Is only reinforcing a very bad situation. So let's stop victim blaming. And the other thing I say, there is no silver bullet, but I do think the two silver bullets are, one, enforced paternity leave for men, Because if we want to be out in leadership in all sectors, but in these strategic STEM sectors in particular, then men need to be staying home more and cooking, by the way. So more enforced paternity leave for men. And the other thing is better and more portrayal of girls and women in media. Like Gina Davis famously says, if she can see it, she can be it. And fortunately now I'm spending a lot of my time in Los Angeles, as much in LA as in Brussels. So I'm also really doing my part to make this impact and get girls and, by the way, adult women thinking, not only can you do technology, not only can you start enterprises that are enabled by technology and even driven by technology, but in order to have the digital society that we want to live in, you must do this.
Thank you. Great recommendations for all of us. Good data to base upon future decisions. So we've seen data and ethics, we've seen leadership. We are now going to see education. Our next speaker is Gloria Poyatos Matas, a judge, founder of the Women Judge Association of Spain. I'll continue in Spanish. Algo que me pidió que dijera, sobre todo, porque su currículum es impresionante y podéis encontrarlo en internet. Su mayor mérito es que se ha dedicado a los cuidados de su hija durante 10 años, lo que le ha aportado la inteligencia emocional que no se enseña en la universidad y las mejores habilidades profesionales para la resolución y gestión de conflictos y decisiones que afectan a colectivos humanos, además de intuición y destreza resolutiva ante problemas imprevistos. Gracias, Gloria.
Bueno, buenos días. Good morning, everybody. Buenos días a todas y a todos. Antes que nada, agradecer a la Asociación Europea de Mujeres Abogadas haber impulsado esta magnífica jornada y, sobre todo, agradecer a su presidenta, Katharina, que está muy ocupada buscando el vídeo, que esto sea una realidad. Yo creo que forma parte de la igualdad real visibilizar el talento femenino y creo que Katharina merece un gran aplauso por habernos congregado aquí a todas. Bueno, tengo muy poco tiempo para hablarles sobre un programa maravilloso que se llama Educando en Justicia Igualitaria. Este no es un programa cualquiera, es un programa de educación en la igualdad desde la justicia y trabajamos como una idea educativa transformativa. Este es el vídeo que me acompaña, que luego lo vamos a poner, porque una imagen vale más que mil palabras y he preferido venir muy armada con las voces de los alumnos, del alumnado y del profesorado. Como les decía, voy a levantarme, si me permiten. Este es un programa de educación transformativa en la que trabajamos desde el socioconstructivismo. Estamos trabajando en la isla de Lanzarote desde el año 2016. Cada año lo venimos implementando y actualmente allí tenemos cerca de 1.000 alumnos adscritos al programa, 12 centros en la isla, pero ya nos hemos extendido a Oviedo, a la Comunidad Autónoma de Valencia. Estamos también en Madrid, estamos también en Badajoz, pronto empezaremos en Andalucía. Perdón, hablo más lento. Voy muy rápida, perdón. Pronto empezaremos en Andalucía, estamos en Gran Canaria y también estamos trabajando en México, donde estamos en la universidad. En Lanzarote y en el resto de los lugares estamos trabajando con un alumnado entre 15 y 18 años, aunque este programa está pensado de 8 a 18 años. Bien, hay tres cualidades fundamentales de este programa que lo hacen único en su especie. El primero es que es eminentemente práctico. Benjamin Franklin tenía una frase muy buena que decía: dime y lo olvido, enséñame y lo recuerdo, involúcrame y lo aprendo. Involucrar a los jóvenes es la seña de identidad de nuestro programa. Los transformamos a golpe de impacto real judicial, generando en ellos recuerdos perennes y generando o provocando cambios transformativos para hacer de ellos seres más críticos y más íntegros, no solo seres empleables. Buscamos que nuestros jóvenes sean capaces de detectar y franquear los estereotipos que son los que sostienen las discriminaciones en los países democráticos. En segundo lugar, y esto es muy importante, no tenemos presupuesto, y esto les encanta a las administraciones públicas, porque empujamos este programa con el activismo y la emoción compartida por los equipos judiciales. ¿Y qué son los equipos judiciales? Son voluntariado procedente de todos los estamentos de la justicia: abogacía, forensía, fiscalía, judicatura, también tenemos cuerpos y fuerzas de seguridad, etcétera. Con lo cual tenemos una visión global de la justicia que vamos a trasladar al alumnado con perspectiva de género. Y la tercera cualidad que creo que es sustancial y también lo hace diferente es que se trata de un aprendizaje o una enseñanza reversible en la igualdad. Fíjense que esto es muy importante. No solo educamos en la igualdad al alumnado al que va dirigido el programa, sino que al educarlos a ellos, los equipos judiciales nos formamos antes en género. Con lo cual hay una reversibilidad formativa que incrementa el avance de igualdad real, tanto en las profesiones que ya estamos trabajando en el juzgado, en los juzgados, como en el joven alumnado que recibe esta información. Muy resumidamente, ya voy acabando, tiene tres partes el programa, que se prolonga a lo largo del curso escolar. La primera fase consiste en que los equipos judiciales nos trasladamos a los centros de enseñanza, interactuamos con los jóvenes y les explicamos en qué consiste nuestra función en el engranaje judicial con perspectiva de género. En segundo lugar, los jóvenes preparan un trabajo vinculado a 8 discriminaciones distintas que les damos a escoger, desde la brecha salarial a la violencia de género, el acoso sexual ocupacional, etc. Y a la vez les llevamos a los juzgados, donde les hacemos una visita guiada y ahí van a ver juicios con perspectiva de género. Quiero decir que no ven cualquier juicio, sino un juicio que nuestros colaboradores jueces y juezas seleccionan previamente, donde está en jaque la igualdad y la discriminación por razón de género. Van a ver el despido de una mujer embarazada, van a ver una reducción de jornada por cuidado de un menor o van a ver una violación. En tercer lugar, y esta es el broche final de nuestro programa, lo que nuestro alumnado está deseando que llegue en todo momento desde el principio, ellos preparan un juicio con perspectiva de género con ayuda de los equipos judiciales. Los llevamos a una sala de vistas real, al edificio judicial, los ataviamos con toga, se reparten los papeles, desde el juez hasta la fiscal o el abogado o abogada, hasta el testimonio y el forense, y celebran un juicio como si fuese un juicio real. Lo escenifican en una sala de vistas donde son grabados y después se llevan el recuerdo. Todo esto va acompañado con cuestionarios que pasamos al alumnado ex ante y ex post para medir el grado de sensibilidad a lo que se denominan micromachismos. Y les aseguro que hay una gran diferencia antes y después. Y como dije anteriormente, una imagen vale más que mil palabras. Y yo no he venido aquí sola, he venido acompañado con el alumnado y el profesorado que van a explicarles ellos mismos qué opinan de este maravilloso programa y a la vez van a ver ustedes mismos trozos, retales de experiencias de los jóvenes celebrando juicios en salas de vista real. Yo acabo ya solo recordando dos frases que creo que son esenciales en este programa. La primera es que nuestros jóvenes no son los adultos del mañana. Son seres del presente que ya pueden ayudar a cambiar la realidad para mejorarla y nos pueden ayudar a caminar hacia una sociedad más corresponsable, más igualitaria y más pacífica. Y la segunda, y esto sí que es la esencia de este programa y por qué pensamos en implementarlo y empujarlo y hacerlo realidad, es que el machismo es una enfermedad de transmisión social y su vacuna está en la educación. Muchas gracias. Perdón. ¿Podemos apagar la luz? ¿Podemos apagar la luz? ¿No?
usted se refiere es bueno, aquella donde tanto mujeres y hombres reciben el mismo respeto por parte de la sociedad y son tratados de la misma forma ante la ley y la sociedad.
La ley consiste en simplemente un trato igualitario, que se den las mismas oportunidades y en una pequeña frase, la igualdad para mí es que no se tenga que hablar de igualdad.
Me encontraba en la cafetería del edificio tomándome un café.
¿Está usted solo, acompañado?
Sí, estaba solo.
¿Y hay alguien que pueda corroborarlo?
Claro, el camarero de la cafetería. Este tipo de acciones van en contra de mis principios morales. Y yo nunca, pero nunca, sería capaz de hacer tal abrazo.
Ha incurrido un delito de acoso sexual ocupacional. Cabe añadir que también se le penará por tratar con inferioridad a la mujer y violar el derecho humano del artículo 23/1 de la Declaración de los Derechos Humanos, derecho a condiciones equitativas y satisfactorias en el trabajo. Lo que se ha visto en esta sala es de extrema gravedad. La sociedad y la justicia no pueden y debe tolerar actuaciones como esta que cosifican a las mujeres y perpetúan las discriminaciones de género. Por tanto...
Absoluto silencio. Procedo a la lectura de la sentencia in voce. Vistos por mí, don Eduardo Toledo Medina, juez del juzgado de lo social número 1 de Recife, los precedentes autos número 328/2017, seguidos a instancia de doña Noelia Malcón, que comparece representada por la letrada doña Dayana Gudelo Sánchez, contra la empresa representada por su dueño, don Diego González Gómez, y asistido por el letrado, don Daniel Nuez Doreste, he llegado a la siguiente conclusión. Puesto que la demandante ha prestado servicios a la empresa demandada durante 16 años sin incentivo alguno, y con un trato deshonesto, evidenciando la brecha salarial y el supuesto techo de cristal, impidiendo que accediera a la junta directiva por ser mujer y tener que compaginar su jornada laboral con la educación y cría de sus hijos, la empresa deberá remunerar a doña Noelia Macón con un total de 60.600 euros, la diferencia de la brecha salarial durante 16 años, sumado a 3.000 euros por daños y perjuicios. Además, a partir de este momento, doña Noelia Macón, jefa de sección, deberá cobrar lo mismo que sus compañeros y tener la oportunidad de acceder a la junta directiva. Se levanta la sesión.
La cara, mira la cara.
Ain't got no home, ain't got no shoes, ain't got no money, ain't got no class, ain't got no skirts.
Esto ha sido un proyecto maravilloso, además de muy importante para... Además de para todo nuestro alumnado, también para nosotros, profesorado, creo que nos hemos acercado más a este tema, estamos ahora más sensibilizados, hemos aprendido mucho, tanto ellos como nosotros. Y bueno, pues esperemos que dentro de poco tiempo no tengamos que estar tratando estos temas que dejen en inferioridad a la mujer con respecto al hombre.
Mi larga experiencia, ya que son unos cuantos años en la educación, tengo que reconocer que este proyecto ha sido muy interesante, muy educativo, Tengo que felicitar a los organizadores de este evento, a las instituciones públicas, al Cabildo Insular, a toda la gente que nos han cedido estas instalaciones, porque el fin último es que estos chicos que estamos aquí, chicas que estamos educando, se conciencien que hay una palabra clave en la sociedad actual y tiene que ser igualdad.
Este proyecto nos ha brindado una oportunidad de tener un poco contacto, pues, cómo va a ser en un futuro nuestro oficio.
Una primera toma de contacto con el sistema judicial español, en concreto con el tema de agresiones sexuales, que es el que hemos tratado.
Nos ha permitido aprender mucho del uno del otro y sobre todo de temas actuales como pueden ser los acosos sexuales.
Se pueden lograr grandes cosas. O sea, esto, no, es cierto que hemos trabajado en ello, pero que tampoco ha sido muy difícil. O sea, solo con darnos la oportunidad ya se puede ver que podemos hacer algo.
Algunos nos queremos dedicar a esto. Y pues ahora tenemos muchas más ganas de dedicarnos a derecho y la igualdad y todo esto.
A los críos.
Gracias, Gloria. Una ilustrativa manera de ver cómo la educación y la educación con medios distintos puede aportar grandes cambios. I wanted to know, Che, what do you think? We just saw how education can change and how different ways of educating can change realities in justice, for example, and equal rights. What do you think on what should kids be learning today to become these adults tomorrow?
Yeah, wow.
Or how should we be teaching?
Well, there's a couple of things that are really brilliant about what my illustrious colleague is doing. One is, of course, creating the role-playing hands-on learning and these exchangings where you're actually making the kids, the people, do what it is that you want them doing, like later in their life. We deploy the same thinking in getting girls and women to become STEM experts, right? So hands-on, role model-led, outcome-oriented, that diffuses the nature of the subject that you're talking about, so whether it's technology or whether it's understanding of the law and gender inequality, these are the things that we need to have, actually all people, because I think it's also a misconception that only young people need to learn these things. If I'm thinking about what Dr. Rippon was saying, this meeting today shouldn't be about focusing on what skills and changes girls and women need, right? We need to be talking to those men who are brainwashing the rest of society about how girls and women cannot do these subject areas. And the other thing is, fortunately, we do things of this kind, so I do, it makes my life very fulfilled to see women who are in their 60s, girls who are 6, 7, 8 years old, who are working with technology and have that epiphany moment and say, yeah, I want to do more of this. So my only comment is, I'd rather that they do science than law, but then maybe they can study artificial intelligence law and data science law, those areas where we need people conscious of the gender dimension as well as the legal.
I have a question here. Isn't it that technology is already a new language that we all have to learn to just bring it to different specialties? So should we be learning, all of us, technology to apply it to law, to medicine, to whatever is our field of expertise?
As long as that extra step happens, because what you see with girls in their teen years in particular is first they all group together and they all track towards languages. So not computer languages, but, you know, the ones that we all are using. And they tend, because of the kind of brainwashing and the ivory towers and this male elitism that says you're not good at this and you'll never be good at this. There's this false distinction between computer languages and natural languages, and that doesn't actually exist. But girls then choose those soft sciences largely because they don't have people in that critical moment telling them that they should go in the other direction. And in those moments, too, the people who are telling them are exactly the people they don't want to be listening to. So I think this is a big challenge, actually. I'm trying to tell my daughter to do science. She's 13. I'm the last person that she's going to listen to at this point, and her teachers as well. So there is this risk, especially girls who have more opportunities. It's true that they tend to be spoiled by the options that they have. And I think that I've been asking for years, is this a problem of luxury? You know, is this a luxury problem? And I think Dr. Rippon helped us to understand that it is socialized, that it is what girls think they should be doing to be nice girls and not doing math. That's not something that girls are good at or that they should be doing. So all of that tells us the stereotypes have to change, and this role-playing thing is really critical.
Gloria, ¿cómo aproximamos la tecnología al mundo judicial y del derecho también?
Bueno, yo quiero centrar un poco la cuestión que estamos hablando, es que hemos de cambiar la manera en que nos enfrentamos a las discriminaciones en los países democráticos. Aquí tenemos la igualdad conquistada legalmente y las leyes, es obvio que han sido insuficientes. En España, además, contamos con dos leyes muy potentes de igualdad y de violencia de género. Y en 40 años las discriminaciones están por todos sitios. Si pensamos en pobreza, las mujeres son más pobres. Si pensamos en trabajo, las mujeres son más desempleadas. Si pensamos en liderazgo, las mujeres están menos representadas. Entonces, ¿cómo debemos abordar las discriminaciones en el siglo XXI? Desde el plano cognitivo. Olvidemos las leyes, no nos están funcionando. Hay que atajar al plano cognitivo. ¿Y eso qué quiere decir? La educación es una gran herramienta en las escuelas, pero también debe acompañarse con la educación social, porque la estereotipia, los estereotipos, que son ilusiones cognitivas irracionales, se transmiten mediante la educación social a través del aprendizaje observacional. Y no podemos decir que somos iguales y sexualizar a las niñas y a las mujeres con cada anuncio televisivo. No podemos decir que somos iguales y tener una Real Academia de la Lengua Española que califique sexo débil como conjunto de mujeres y sexo fuerte como conjunto de hombres. Y no podemos decir que somos iguales y que nuestros hijos e hijas en los libros de textos no vean ni una sola faz de mujer científica o en otras modalidades. No podemos decir que somos iguales y actuar como si no lo fuésemos. No podemos a nuestros niños y niñas decir que somos iguales y establecer uniformes sexualizados. En el caso de las niñas, con faldas incómodas que les impide hacer deporte en los recreos porque se le ve la ropa interior. Tengo el caso de mi hija pequeña, que tiene que ir con un pantalón corto al colegio. Y así muchísimos ejemplos. Por tanto, yo creo que hemos de abordar el enfoque con nuevas herramientas desde la feminidad. Herramientas que no se han explorado, feministas, para promover cambios reales en la sociedad. Y uno de ellos, ¿saben cuál creo que es? La extensión de la práctica de cuidar. Porque cuidar no es solo imprescindible para el sostenimiento de la vida cotidiana. Cuidar es importante por las habilidades que genera en la persona que practica los cuidados. Valores de empatía, valores de tolerancia, valores de respeto, valores de paciencia, valores de responsabilidad. Y sobre todo, el respeto a la diversidad. Porque yo estoy segura que hasta que los cuidados no se conviertan en el trabajo social productivo más importante de nuestra sociedad, no conquistaremos la igualdad real. Por tanto, eso es lo que pienso.
Verdad. Wow.
uno de los retos, ¿no? One of the challenges, es introducir estos cuidados en el diseño del mundo digital, ¿no? How are we going to tackle algorithms to include ethics, to include this view that Gloria was explaining?
Well, the danger of this discussion is that already the what they call the singularity, right? The society where the robots and humans merge. This is already upon us. What machines are out there doing today? Do you know about the language that two machines taught themselves to communicate to each other in a way that humans do not understand? So this situation is already upon us. If I didn't make clear that it's urgent. What are we going to do to change that? There is a catch-22 situation because the decision makers and policy makers about the digital society are also all men, right? We don't even have women who are making these decisions, and the same women. So I'm also looking at you who step away from technology because we don't understand it. We are told we don't understand it. We have fear about it. These same women, you women, us women, don't take on these questions because they are afraid of them. They do not take on the policy discussions either. They do not make the rules. They do not engage in the discussions where the decisions are being made around these subjects. So we have a very, very difficult problem here. That for me, it is a systemic problem. It is a danger, as has been shared on this stage today. The answer is a systemic response. Quotas. Absolutely. We are very fortunate now in Europe to have a president of the European Commission who is a woman and a feminist, although she's toned down the message a bit. She is talking about a balanced Europe. We have a balanced commission, and we have very key women who are leading the discussion on the research agenda in Europe, on the digital agenda in Europe. So these are a bit of some cracks in the patriarchy that I think are promising, but again, two key things. You have to step up to the plate. Don't carry on the same fears that are going to make it more and more difficult for us to be involved in the discussion and lead in the discussion. The other thing, do not tell me that you are a feminist. Do not stand on this stage and go speak at events saying that you care about women if you are shutting down women in your job, in your daily job, if you are not bootstrapping women. So I'm also going to challenge you to raise up other women on your LinkedIn profile. Don't look at them more carefully than you do a man who asks you for the same kinds of help. Right? Don't be super critical. Don't internalize and be afraid to help each other because it's only in those ways. So the women who are in leadership today, I implore you, make a space for young women. Make space for women who represent parts of the discussion that you don't. Because yes, we can also fall prey to not being diverse among our groups of women, especially even in the mission of promoting gender equality. I've been a victim of this treatment countless times. So let's stop that and give ourselves key performance indicators. This week, I am going to send that many emails for other women. I am going to share that many other CVs. I am going to open up these positions to women and make sure that they get them. So there is stuff that we can be doing every day that moves the bar forward. And again, not only should we be doing, can we be doing, but we must be doing those things.
Sí. Solo estoy totalmente de acuerdo con lo que ha dicho, solo que sé que es un ejercicio de valentía, pero hemos de reivindicar nuestra diversidad. Las mujeres tenemos que salir del armario e intentar reivindicar cómo somos y no imitar a los hombres, que hasta ahora era lo que teníamos, la imitación. O sea, yo no critico a las mujeres que, imitando a los hombres, han llegado a altos puestos de poder. Pero yo creo que ha llegado la hora de reivindicar nuestra diversidad y poner en valor las emociones, poner en valor los cuidados, poner en valor una serie de valores que se asocian a la feminidad y que han sido despreciados históricamente por nuestro derecho. Yo soy del mundo de la justicia, ella viene de otro mundo, de otro estamento, y aquí hay profesiones de todos los lugares, pero cada una en nuestro trabajo tenemos que intentar hacerlo. Yo en mi caso, ya lo digo, estoy en un órgano colegiado, estoy en un tribunal con otros muchos hombres y podéis imaginaros lo que me cuesta cuando voy con una interpretación jurídico-legal que intento hacer con perspectiva de género. A pesar de ello, intento desde la fundamentación seguir mi línea y si no los convenzo, utilizo el voto particular, que es un criterio jurídico que queda en la sentencia y que a lo mejor en un futuro se he seguido por otras sentencias. Por tanto, yo creo que estar aquí hoy, este encuentro, es un magnífico punto de referencia para seguir caminando y desde aquí salir refortalecidas, porque esto es una terapia colectiva, salimos de aquí muy reforzadas. Y cuando vayamos a la panadería, cuando llevemos a los niños al colegio, cuando vayamos al trabajo, hacer feminismo allí donde vayamos.
Pues ética, ¿no? Ética, liderazgo, educación y más mujeres ayudando a mujeres y a comer.
¡Yeah, a comer!